Okay, go ahead.
All right. Andy, one of the things Andy had asked me to talk about was my relationship with my father. I've tried to think back on that, and I have very fond memories of my father, but after all, he's been dead for 60 years now, and it's so I may not be able to hit it just the way I should, because I think you know my father was a career army officer who was in the ROTC in college in Colorado, and then went on active duty in World War I and went overseas. And after the war was over, they offered selected officers a chance to stay on as a career, and he did that. Now, he was also an officer in the Army Corps of Engineers, which made him a little bit different than the usual, the military officer we tend to think of, because the Corps of Engineers is actively involved in river and harbor work, as they call it, handling floods and trying to channel the Mississippi, flood control, and that's essentially a civilian type operation. And when serving in that capacity, they didn't wear their uniforms. So about half of my time growing up, my father was a civilian, and half the time he was a military man. And I'll say that his military side, he was not austere or anything remotely like that. He was a very warm person, and he and I got along very well, subject to the usual altercations between father and son. But as I observe my own children, Andy and Leslie, with their children, life was quite different in those days. Children did not engage in the range of activities with their parents that they do today, or at least I didn't. I lived in places where there were always a swarm of kids of my age, and we palled around together, and in the earlier years had no money to do many interesting, that is, camps and things like that. So the kids tended to be more on their own, and the parents went their separate way. It was a warm family relationship, but we engaged in fairly few family activities as such. And that, as I say, was because he had this sort of a split life, military and civilian. I wound up going to West Point. My father asked me various times when I was in high school, why are you so set on going to West Point? Do that for me. I think it's entirely up to you. I've saved a little money to pay for your education, and you don't feel you have to go to West Point. But for some reason, I've never been able to put my finger on it, I was determined to go to West Point from early time I can remember, and never wavered, even though he asked me to think about if that was what I really wanted to do. So we had various frank exchanges about that, and I've sometimes fantasized that maybe in the days when he was in the military side of the engineers, and wearing dress uniforms and things like that, that somehow in my, it got through to me, I was impressed by that, and that became sort of a reason I wanted to be like my father and look at dashing, and those were the days of uniforms with boots and breeches and very spiffy, I guess you'd say, copy. My father, I might say, had a childhood which was, shocks me every time I think about it. He was, his mother and father, both of whom were very austere type people, married, divorced, remarried, and re-divorced each other. And in the, after the second divorce, they abandoned him to a much older maiden aunt, a wonderful woman, who essentially raised him. And went to high school in Newton, Mass. His grandfather was a leading political figure in the town at the time. But then he went off to, started at MIT, and I didn't find this out till close to the end of his life. He decided at the end of first year of MIT to commit suicide, stuck his head in a gas oven, and the landlady fortunately smelled it, and he was rescued, and the doctors urged him to leave Boston and go out, go to the mountains or something like Rockies. So that's where he wound up in Colorado, going to Colorado College, and that's where he met my mother too. Now, there's one kind of ironic thing thinking about my father. When I arrived back in the States from Italy in the hospital, my parents were there the first day to greet me. And they split up and took turns, and my father at that time told me about his attempted suicide. I'd never heard of it before, never even been suggested. In many ways, he was the last guy I would have thought would do something like that. And I kind of, I wondered, why is he telling me this at this particular time? And I finally decided the answer was, I never verified it, was he was so worried that this loss of sight and depression and despair that went with it might lead me to try and go the suicide route. At least that's my thought. And he wanted, pointed out to me how all he would have missed in his life, and to say nothing of the fact I wouldn't have existed if he hadn't pulled out of it. And so don't you, what he was saying to me is, don't go that route. Look at all I would have missed. That's what you would have missed. And of course, he was absolutely right. And life being what it is, that was the first day I was back in the hospital from the hospital ship, and he died the next morning at the hospital from a heart attack. And that was, of course, compounded the impact of blindness at the time, and was particularly hard on my mother. And I'll just say one final thing. Ironically, it's sort of difficult to say this, but I think I've had a fairly successful career It certainly has been rewarding as far as I'm concerned, but I think of my, ironically, if my father had lived, it might have gone in a much different way and nowhere near as satisfactorily. None of us in the family knew, you know, what blind people do or what you're good for anymore. And he was, due to his engineer work, he knew the head of American Airlines, a man at the time, and was going to contact him. And we talked, in our ignorance, was sort of one of the possibilities that he was going to explore with this head of the airlines, was whether I could get a job somewhere as a radio operator on the ground, communicating with the airplanes. Well, if it hadn't been that, it might have been something equally unstimulating. And so I feel sort of disloyal in a way, but ironically, I think things turned out much better for him, because we might well have tried to take this shortcut. I probably wouldn't have gone to law school, and things might have been quite different from the wonderful way things have worked out, both in a professional sense and, more importantly, in terms of the family. I wouldn't have met Enid. I wouldn't have had these three children. They wouldn't have had me. And so, in a strange way, awful a blow as that was, I think his desire to help me might well have set me off on the what in retrospect would seem to be the wrong track. Well, that's
one question, if I may, on the heart attack. Do you feel that the heart attack was in some way caused or was partially
condition? I have no feelings, nor did my mother, that my being wounded contributed to that at all. He was having, as I learned later, he was having problems in the weeks and months beforehand. He never exercised. He smoked three packs of cigarettes every day of his life. And I just think, I don't think there was any connection. I've never had the slightest guilt feeling about that.
Yeah. Do you think, I guess the other thing I wanted to ask you is your, his telling you about his failed attempt at suicide. Do you think that's something he planned on telling you several days before he saw you, or do you think that was a spontaneous a story on his part when he finally did sit down with you and talk to you?
I guess I don't really feel I can speculate. It could be either way. I mean, we got in this very, this came out in a very, my mother left the two of us together to talk, and we talked for 2 or 3 hours. This was part of it, and it may be just that the as we talked very frankly and warmly, intimately, that this just came out as he saw me there and was concerned. On the other hand, perhaps he thought about this ahead of time.
Sorry. Go ahead.
What did it fall off something?
There's something just fell over, but it's all right. Well, tell me, that was the last time you were obviously together alone.
Yes.
Do you have other memories when you were younger of things, times and places you were together with him doing just sort of pure father-son type of things? Places you traveled to or events? Annual events on the various military bases where you were growing up, things that you remember doing, just the two of you doing together?
Not specifically. We that we traveled together mainly when we changed, you know, in the Army you move every year or two, and when we moved we traveled there, my mother and the dog along with it, but he and I did, I don't recall that he and I ever did all that much together, the two of us, and I'm so struck by the way you and Leslie particularly are so involved in your children's lives. Is that the front door?
Yeah, let me just pause, start up again.
All right, I think I was saying when we broke off here that in relation to activities with my father and me, I don't know whether it was the times the parents weren't that involved with their children's activities, or whether it was the kind of the life we led, because while I'm an only child and my father was an only child and my mother just had one brother who was more alienated from the family almost most of the time, we still had, particularly on the military post, we still have crowds of children who travel together, and even on the civilian communities, river and harbor work, I was always part of a crowd going around, and somehow it didn't seem that children were doing that have shared as many activities with their parents as the wonderful scene I see in this family.
Was your father, do you think, throughout his career when you were growing up, would you think he thought of himself as a success?
Yes, I think so. Yes, he did, and he had certain measurements for that. The thing that worked the other way, although they brought a bunch of officers in to the Army in World War I and created what they called the hump of officers in the promotion area, and so my father was a captain for 17 years, and as most of his contemporaries went through that, but since his contemporaries were there, were sharing the faith, had some good jobs, and then he went on, he became a general, and I think he felt he was a success, although I sometimes wonder at the very end when he was in the Pacific, in the Pacific during World War II, before he came back when I arrived, I think there could have been a question in his mind, because it did seem he was a little off the beaten track as far as early hotshot jobs were concerned. But we never talked about that.
Going back to that, building off of that, how did you feel, even though your father didn't live to influence and direct your career after the military in a direct sense, how do you feel, though, that in your subsequent career, both in law school and in the government, do you feel that your work ethic or your attitude towards work was shaped in some important respect by your father's attitude towards his own work and what you observed of that attitude?
Yes, I think so. He was a hard-driving guy, although he was didn't have a tough persona, but he was a hard-driving guy, and I think I picked that up from him. I was exposed to it. I knew he was a hard worker, and in the West Point years and just before, he had some very good jobs, and so I think I in that sense, I think I was influenced by his hard work was the way to get ahead, and of course law school helps in that way anyway, because everyone works hard in law school, and then that could set the pattern for you.
Do you ever remember having discussions with him before you went off to Italy, or even before you went to West Point, about what you might do for work and what your profession might be?
Well, vaguely. I was so set on West Point, it didn't go very far. But in those years, the high school years, he was head of, or I can't remember, his head or deputy of ROTC at MIT. And he told me, as I mentioned earlier, when he said, you know, don't get set on West Point. It's all right with me, and you might want to consider MIT. And he offered to introduce me to some people there that might be helpful if I wanted to go to MIT. But he had engineering talents and abilities, and I had none of those, and really had, even though I toyed with MIT because of reputation, I never really took it seriously, and it would have been the wrong place for me anyway.
As much as he kept trying to convince you that it wasn't his goal that you go to West Point, how in the years you were at West Point, how did he respond to that?
Oh, he was very, I think he was proud of me that I was there, and that I made it and graduated. So I don't think he had any reservations as I went on through there, and I wasn't high enough in my class to get into the Army Engineers, but I was better off in the artillery that I went into anyway. So I think he was proud of the way it worked out.
Uh-huh. Did he visit you at West Point several times?
Several times, yeah, including the day of Pearl Harbor. He came up, he was stationed in Puerto Rico at the time, and he came up with some officers on a business trip or something, and took a side trip to West Point, and there was also the question of the usual thing of buying a car for graduation. Everybody got a car from their parents if they could afford it at the time of graduation, and he came up to see me and also decide on the car, and that was, we just finished lunch on Sunday at the Thayer Hotel there and came out, and there was Pearl Harbor on the radio.
Mm.
And he said something to the effect, well, this is going to change all of our lives drastically. The understatement of the year.
Yeah, yeah. How about sort of switching maybe to the personal side? When you were, this is now, of course, 10 years later, when you yourself became a father, three times over.
Happily.
And your children began to grow. How did you feel? I think we've all gone through the phase of oh my gosh, now what do I do?
Yeah.
What does it mean to be a father? And yeah. And obviously we look to our own fathers in some respects for yeah. guidance, in at least through experience, if not through a conversation. And unfortunately you didn't have the ability to have a conversation with him at that stage.
But, yeah.
Looking back, as you were harnessing yourself into the role of fatherhood, what do you see as some of the things perhaps that you did draw from your experience with your father, either positively or maybe negatively, in a sense of saying, well, I'm going to do it differently with my own children?
Well, I'll tell you, there's one thing I've never forgotten since the hard work we talked about earlier, even as you all came along, I wanted to, I was committed to hard work, both bring it at home, stay at the office, and all the rest, and I guess to the neglect of my children, and those being the days when that's what the wife took care of the children, you took care of the career and worked on it and like that. But I still remember in this very house, in the living room by the French doors, I remember my wife, whose name is Enid, said to me, this is almost a direct quotation, you know, you're letting your children grow up with very little contact with you because you're so caught up in your work. And for some incredible reason, she said it very pleasantly and but firmly, and for some incredible reason it registered with me. And while I didn't, not saying I went on to be a paragon there, it did change my attitude. I made a real effort, and it made a difference.
Hmm.
I remember that moment so clearly, exactly where we were standing when she said that.
How old were your children at the time, would you guess?
You might have been 4 or 5.
Uh-huh.
In that range. And to the extent it did spur me, and I'm that didn't make me an ideal father or anything like that, but it made a difference in my attitude and in my actions. Probably not enough, but it did.
Mm-hmm. Can you imagine your parents having had the same conversation?
No, I guess not, but I'm not sure why. I guess it was the times when Enid said that to me. Times were changing a little bit. I wasn't changed. It took that to get me started changing, but times had changed, and it goes back again to the. In no way did I feel not close to my parents or at arm's length, but we just shared very few activities together as I was growing up. That's the way. That's the way it was in those days.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember. I don't remember that with my other friends and anything. I do remember with my friends, and it was the same all around. We were we palled around and in a group, and the parents did, and we'd take a vacation together or something like that. But nothing compared to the way in which you and the others share in the activities of a wonderful way you do with your children. But I, again, I think it's partly the times.
One of the things I think I've certainly enjoyed very much since I was in college onward is the sort of really what I guess I would call adult conversations I've had with you, and many ranging over many, many topics. And of course, again, unfortunately, your father died before you had much of that time. But during the time you were at West Point or you visited with him, do you feel, did you start to develop a relationship, a more of an adult-to-adult relationship, where you would talk about a wide variety of subjects and listen to each other and really exchange information or exchange thoughts and feelings and attitudes? Or was it were you sort of stuck in a way in that era more in a sort of, I guess, a child-father relationship?
Well, not so much. The answer is no. We didn't really involve ourselves in those types of conversations, or at least not very much. And also by that time, if we're talking about particularly about the end of high school and off to West Point, you know, in those years from the time I left to go to West Point until I wound up in the hospital having that talk with him, we have very few times together. Oh, I want to say one thing about my father. I just remember we had one vacation at West Point halfway through, 2 months, 3 months, and they were living in Puerto Rico, and I went down to Puerto Rico for that summer. And since I was a Red Cross life guard examiner, they're building up the forces, and troops were pouring into Puerto Rico, and they were building swimming pools to help recreation. They drafted me to give lessons to about 30 or 40 troops to be lifeguards at these new pools. Well, but as the class came to an end, as the end approached, the Puerto Ricans who were in my class, they could hardly swim, let alone save anybody. And the word got out, I've forgotten just how this happened, but the word got out that I wasn't going to be able to give certificates to any of the native Puerto Ricans. And this came to the attention of the general down there, my father's boss, the Army general in charge of the Puerto Rican area. And the word was passed to me that it could be upsetting if the word got around in the Puerto Rican community that I had failed these men in their examinations, or that they wouldn't get their certificates. It was sort of a you know, had racial overtones to it. Well, this word came from the general's office, and my father knew about it and heard about it. It got to me. I'd said I wouldn't give them the certificate. It would be dangerous for people that might need their help, or even for them, and I wouldn't do it. That general was a key man in my father's career in the military. Father served directly under him. His, what he wrote Washington about my father would play a big part in his career. My father never once said anything to me about changing my mind or could I see my way clear to it. He just stayed out of it totally. And I not only appreciated it, but I admired it, because it wouldn't have been too far out of line to maybe twist my arm a little bit or something, but he didn't do it.
Did you talk about it at all with him, or it just wasn't even a subject for discussion?
It wasn't a subject of conversation.
Uh-huh. Did you,
He got to be a general in spite of it.
Yes. He was a colonel at this time,
Right.
Do you think your father wanted more children?
I have no idea. My mother couldn't have any more. After I was born, she had a hysterectomy, I believe it was, after I was born, and couldn't have any more. I never knew whether she or he regretted that, and they certainly was never the slightest idea of adoption or anything like that. But there we were. He was an only child. I was. My mother was just had this one kind of brother whose life was unfortunate in many ways, and so it just didn't seem that important to them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what they'd grown up with, and there it was.
All right, why don't...
We're talking about the year 1989, and at that point, Leslie and Sasha were living in Rome, and they invited me to come over and visit with them for a couple of weeks, and I was delighted and naturally thought I might get to Anzio when I was there, and it turned out that they had planned on doing that during my visit. So we drove down from, I think it was Lake Bolsena, but we drove from there, I think, not Rome. But anyway, we drove to the beach, and I had prepared for this ahead of time by going to the Library of Congress a couple of months before and getting copies of battle maps that were used for the Anzio landing. And so I took those along, and they were very detailed and very helpful. So we got in our car on a hot summer Italian day and drove from over to Anzio, and to our dismay, when we arrived at the beach area, we found it was all fenced off, and the Italians had done what every military around the world does when they see a good beach area where they and their families can have it. They fence it off and say, we need this for military purposes. And so there it was, and there was a guard at the gate, and I was sort of crushed because I'd wanted to visit this, and I'd told Leslie, and we talked about it a couple of days before that and much earlier, hence I had gotten those maps. So there we were at the gate, and I was feeling sort of rather deflated, and whereupon Sasha jumps out of the car, goes up, speaks to the sentry, is ushered in, and 5 or 10 minutes later, comes back with a Italian sergeant and a car. And he had told them that I'd made the landing there. They were all they were very interested. And, you know, in some ways, this 89, 44, that was, they'd read about it in the history books. So I, when this sergeant came over and talked to him, I pulled out my big Library of Congress battle map, and he instantly saw that there were markings on it, and the beach where I landed was called X-Ray Beach, and I had Sasha tell him that's where I landed. Oh yeah, I know that. He knew that right away. So we jumped in the car, and I'm really feeling wonderfully set up about it, and Leslie and Sasha are as excited as I was. So we roared down along this beach road, suddenly stopped at a point, and got out, and he told them this was X-Ray Beach, where we were. And so I, remembering the landing, I knew when I got out of the duck on the beach and started inland to look for a position for the artillery howitzers, there had been, a road had wended its way through the sand dunes into the back of it, and somehow we communicated this to this guy, and we walked over, and there was that road, a rutted road, the same road, the very road that I had found after I landed and had followed inland to decide where guns would go to be able to fire and also be away from the beach for the expected German attack. And so so at that point I grabbed Leslie and said, from the location of this road going inland, we walked out to the water's edge and turned around, and I said, now this is from the map and everything, and that road, this is exactly where I jumped down from that duck. And just as we were starting to walk inland, there was that shell that you've seen, that shell that she has today, in that wooden paperweight at her house. And so we picked that up as marking the place. But then, and so then we walked inland, and I followed this very same road, two sandy tracks more or less. There it was. It seemed, felt under my feet just the way it had when I'd walked a little before dawn on it toward inland to look for these positions. And of course I got very excited, because this is that very road. And I fired up Leslie and Sasha, and they made a connection there between that day many years before, and here was a daughter. So we followed the road up, and it came to a paved road, which was the same one I had walked up to, but it was fenced off because of this fencing around the reservation. So I said, well, let's go out here and get on the other side of this fence and cross the highway. So we went to the gate, thanked the sergeant, drove over to the place on the paved road opposite where this other sandy road had crossed, and we got out there, and Leslie and I walked. The road picked up as it had in that day. The road picked up sandy tracks going through a woods, just pretty much the way it had been when I'd gone through, when I landed there. And so I kept sort of hugging Les and said, this is incredible. And there was a plaque there marking not our particular landing, but marking an American of troops there. So we followed that route, that winding road further inland through some woods, and there we're able to find a couple of places where we had put our guns. And it was just, Leslie and I were sort of hugging each other and saying, this is incredible. And all those years ago, and there we were, and with a daughter, and somehow mixed emotions, of course, but somehow I started to say completed something. That's not really the right word, but it sort of joined my present life and my daughter with that time almost 50 years before. And so we were all elated, felt we'd triumphed, went off and found a place with good Italian beer and sandwiches and lived it up. A very stirring moment for me, and I think for Les too.
And interestingly enough, of course, Leslie and Sasha were married the next year.
Yes, right.
And this was presumably one of your first sort of in-depth experiences with Sasha.
That's exactly right. Exactly. And of course, by the time we made this trip, I'd spent two or three or four days together, and I'd felt I was getting to know him a little bit, and we were enjoying, the three of us were enjoying each other, and we went out to dinner, and so with the whole the ambience of the personal relationships were just conducive to this connection.
Did you in all this have any hesitation about sort of how they, the younger generation, if you will, would react, or the level of interest they might have in sort of chasing around your memories and experiences? Or was that really not an issue for you before you got there or while you were there? I mean, were they as interested as you would have wanted them to be? And
they were as interested as I would want them to be, but it was just, right, they sort of shared my enthusiasm for this kind of juncture in my life of coming around full circle in some ways, and I think they shared my feelings, and there wasn't any element, not the slightest element of any kind of, oh my God, this guy lost his sight here, right here, and everything. None of that. We were just enjoying it so much and had such a sense of accomplishment that we had found the very place that I had stepped ashore and on right into where we were, let's put the guns in. So it was just was just right.
It's now 17 years after that, and I know you've spent some time recently, in particular, studying and reviewing what happened at Anzio. Do you feel that that was sort of the one time you'd go back? Would you like to, if you could, go back again because you know more about it, or your attitude towards it has changed? And I guess a related question: did that visit back 17 years ago sort of reignite an interest on your part in terms of studying the battle and what happened there those many years ago?
Well, it hasn't rekindled. I mean, none of this work. This is you're referring to this book, John Eisenhower's book, that I'm making contributions to, and it has stirred up my interest in the battle and what was at stake and all the rest. And I have written some anecdotes about the landing and experiences after that, which some of which will appear in the book, but it hasn't kindled any desire to, in my mind, to go back on the land. It's an intellectual thing now of that battle and its misguided elements, it's an intellectual thing now, and not in writing these anecdotes for John, they haven't stirred up any, they've given me some laughs, but they haven't stirred up any nostalgic or fateful feelings or anything like that.
Mm-hmm. Now, of course, you talked about retracing the steps you took and what you did the first few hours there. But if I remember correctly, you lived for some months in that area after the landing had taken place and a firm beachhead was established.
Yeah.
Did you retrace any of your other steps there?
Well, you're quite right. It wasn't. We moved on from there further away inland and off toward the south of the beachhead, and I guess I need to ask you, just repeat your question. I've drifted a little bit there.
Well, I'm just curious as to, you had other experiences in that part of Italy for some months.
Yes.
Did you have an interest or desire to go, or did you actually go to some of those places? And
we spent several hours. I remembered the layout of the roads there. And they were paved, they were narrow paved roads, Mussolini roads, and I tried to trace down to where I wound up spending the 2 or 3 months after that, but between the fact I couldn't see it, even though I knew the room layout, and most of all, the area was incredibly built up. It was now, it was sort of a beach area with a lot of restaurants and things.
Couldn't live through the hate. Michelle, President Franklin D. Roosevelt.
Yeah, right.
And here is Andrew.
How about her?
Can I have one?
the camera along with Grandpa and I'll meet you over there, okay?
Okay. Can I keep filming?
If you want.
Okay, just be careful. I don't want it right now. Anyway, I have this.
That's not all for yourself.
Yeah, dude.
What is
it? It's also for you.
No, it's not all for you.
I said it's also for you.
You all know that this is a, by now, that this is a World War II memorial, and I think you all know about World War II, which was about 16-some years ago, a long time ago, and began when the Japanese attacked our Navy in Hawaii and sank a whole bunch of ships in a sneak attack. And we declared war on them. They were Japanese, and you saw the arches for the memorial, one for the Pacific, one for the Atlantic. So the Pacific one began after that attack on Hawaii, Pearl Harbor. We declared war on them. They were under the control of generals and so on, backed up by the emperor. It was not a democracy, it was a military dictatorship in Japan. At the same time, even before that in Europe, there was a man called Hitler who was a dictator of Germany, and by the time Pearl Harbor attack came, he had conquered most of Europe, those countries that you all know about, France and England. Well, not England, was saved because she was the island, but on the mainland, France and Norway and all of those countries in between the Italian area, Spain, they were all occupied by Germans, and Hitler wanted to rule Germany, and he said he would. After Pearl Harbor and the attack, Hitler thought we were so badly wounded by that attack that he declared war on us. And then finally, he declared war on the Russians. So he was what we call a two-front war. He was fighting people in Europe. And then behind him to the east, he began to fight the Russians. And that was the scene. That's why they called it a world war. Japan had taken over all of the nations in Asia and the islands. Hitler had done that. He was attacking Russia. And so we united with the British and others, and gradually began to build tanks and planes and train soldiers. And that's when I was being trained at West Point and afterwards. And then, but by the time it was over, 16 million American men were in the Army, Navy, and Air Force. And then the battles began, and today when you walked around, you see the names of the various battles as the Americans fought their way into Europe and to capture Germany. The Russians were attacking from the other side, trying to get Russia. Our Navy was sinking ships belonging to the Japanese in the Pacific, and gradually it closed in on all of them. My own personal experience when I went over, my war was in Italy, and you can, not all that far from a music festival that goes on in Italy these days, and you can see the name of a battle over on one of the stones. It's called Anzio. And gradually, we fought the Germans, forced them back up Italy into Europe, came across the channel from Britain, attacked them there, and gradually pushed them back to Berlin. And then the Russians came from there on the other side and crashed, and we caught them between us and destroyed them. And in Japan, we started out mainly with the Navy and fighting on all sorts of Pacific islands, fighting our way toward Japan, gradually conquering one island after another, and finally we were able to get on the an island close to Japan. That's when the nuclear bombs got dropped, two of them, and the Japanese surrendered soon after that, and the war was over in the Pacific in summer of 45, and over in Europe a little earlier in the spring of 1945, and then the 16 million Americans and all the ships gradually came back home, and we had peace for all of the 10 or 15 years. And not far from here, there's a memorial called the Korean Memorial, because World War II ended in 45. In 1950, the Korean War began, and we had to become involved. And there's actually a memorial to the Koreans that we may see sometime, probably another time. So that's kind of the picture, and this memorial is to salute the men who fought those battles and the large number who were killed in them, and the many that were wounded and destroyed. Hitler and the Japanese, who wanted to dominate the whole world if they could. So it was in Italy. And you all know what Italy, even if you haven't been to the music festival yet. Well, no, almost everybody's been, I guess. But you know Italy is like a boot. And we landed, the Germans held Italy. We landed it down by the toe of the boot, fought our way up north toward Rome. That's when I was there with artillery. And as we fought our way up, and then we had took a bunch of troops in ships and went around and landed behind the German lines. And I was with the dead group, and that's where Anzio was. And we threatened the Germans and eventually forced them back to Rome and then on toward the end. The end of the war came when they were still a few of them in northern Italy, but the major part of the war then was being fought in Europe and in Germany. Mm-hmm.
Marie F.
Yeah.
Wife of B.G., James F. C. Hyde, USA.
April 14th, 79. Oh, yeah, that was for a moment. It's 79.
Uh-huh,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd forgotten that was near your birthday.
Well, and what about?
Okay, over here.
Not 15, more than 15.
No, 15. When she died.
James F. C. Hyde, Massachusetts, Brig General, U.S. Army, April 29th, 1894, August 7th, 1944.
Are they all around here?
Yes.
And fellows, I say a couple of things here. I think you probably know now that we're in Arlington Cemetery, which is the national cemetery for the United States, and mainly for soldiers, not soldiers, sailors, airmen, are buried here, and also more recently, President Kennedy is also buried here, and this is the sort of the, well, it's the, its name is what it is. National Cemetery is what it's all about. Now, this river we just came over, the Potomac River, when the Civil War was going on one side of the river, the side where the World War II memorial is, that was the north. And this side of the river was the south. The Potomac was pretty much the dividing line during that war. And after that war was over, this land was taken, set aside, and many, many veterans of the Civil War were buried here. And still are, and from many wars, men have been buried since. And this, your great grandfather, General Hyde, died during World War II, and then his wife, we call Grammy in her years. Well, as you can see, is also buried here. And this, since I was also in the service, I will be buried here, right next to my father and mother, and grandma here will be buried here also as a wife. So what, you remember what I said before when you were at the World War II Memorial, someday you'll come back and say to each other, remember that time when we were there with so on? Well, maybe you'll come out here sometime with your own children and say to each other, remember that day when we were all here, all 14 of us, and we came out here? And here we are back again, and that's where you tell your children, your great-great-grandparents, and great-grandparents all be buried right here. So remember, when you come back with your children years from now, remember, I'm thinking about it. It makes me feel so good thinking that you will come back sometime and remember this very day, this minute that we were standing here. So, I hope you will visit sometime. If not, won't be sad. It'll be just the time that life goes on, and you can, with your children, as we, with you, point out that life went on here when your great-grandmother was buried. Uncle Andy and Uncle Tracy and Leslie, we were all here together for that. And here we are today. We didn't have any of you at that time, so it goes on. And Arlington is a pretty stirring place to have it go on, as is Washington. All right. That have blanks in them, and they fire 3 volleys. That's the traditional thing for the burial of a soldier. Ready, aim, fire 3 times, and then a moment of silence, and then nearby is a bugler who plays taps. Do you all know taps?
Yes.
Yes, I'm sure you have heard it. And everybody who's come to the burial stands there while the firing happens, the playing of taps, and then it's over. And when you come to a military funeral, you march very slowly, bringing the body back, bringing the body to the grave. You march very slowly. The drums are slow, music. The soldiers who are escorting the casket walk slowly. Then when they have the burial, and the firing of the 3 rounds and then taps, then there's a moment of silence, and then immediately they start on the drums and bugles, and they march away at their regular fast pace to show that life goes on after the burial. The army and life goes on, so you start marching at your regular pace from then on.
Expression should I have?
You
here?
Should have one of peace and tranquility and pleasure.
No, Jake, just
all
stay
right.
Open.
Oh, that's perfect. That's wonderful.